Yeah, here. So anyway, good evening and thank you for joining us for another virtual program brought to you by the Mattapoisett Museum. My name is Kyle DeCicco Carey and I'm president of the board of directors of the museum. Tonight, our program is offered to you free of charge, but we do encourage donations to help offset the cost of this and future programs. After our event, you will receive an email survey, which includes a link to our donation page. Your feedback is important to us, and we do welcome your feedback. The Mattapoisett Museum is a 501c3 educational nonprofit. We have a mission to be a vibrant place of learning and community activities and open to all people. We are a small and ambitious museum focusing on history, art, and culture. If you're not a member, we do encourage you to join and support our mission. You can join today at mattapoisettmuseum.org/membership. I would also like you to know that we have a new online gift shop. You can find posters, greeting cards, museum publications, and more. We're featuring our latest book, Memory Lane, Walks and Stories Around Mattapoisett Village by Francis C. Rowland. This is a self-guided tour as told by Mr. Rowland, full of fascinating and entertaining local history and lore. You can get a copy at etsy.com/shop/Mattapoisett Museum. So let's get started. Just a reminder, Zoom etiquette rules apply tonight. Please mute yourself for the entirety of the event. If you have questions or comments, please put them into the chat and we'll read them during the Q&A portion of the event, which will take place at the end. Tonight, we welcome Catherine Gilliland. She comes to us from the Kennedy Library Foundation, where she is the docent manager. And to show our appreciation to Catherine for taking the time to come out and talk to us tonight, we're going to send her a copy of the museum's classic publication, Picture Postcard Memories of Mattapoisett. So if you just give us a few minutes here, we'll switch screens and Catherine can take over here.
All right, can everyone hear me all right?
Yes.
Okay. I'll share my screen in just a moment. Thank you so much for having me. My name is Catherine Gilliland. I am the docent manager at the JFK Library in Boston. There are two former docents in the crew here watching, so I just have to say hello. It's really great to see you all. I haven't seen them in years, so that's a very nice, good to see some familiar faces. Thank you so much for having me. Thank you, Jeff and Kyle and Darcy, especially for setting this up and inviting me to speak. I'm excited to be with you all tonight. I will be talking about Jacqueline Kennedy's White House Restoration Project. And we're hoping that whether you're a member of the museum or of the Mattapoisett Museum or tuning in from somewhere else, if you're interested in museums and White House history, I'm going to take you behind the scenes of the White House Restoration Project and hopefully not get too into the weeds of the process, but hopefully pulled out some interesting stories for you that you will enjoy. So I can't see myself. Can you all help me?
Yes, you did just share your screen.
And, it looked great.
And then you unshared it, I think.
Right, so how do I get, oh, speaker view, okay. Okay. See, we're a year into this almost and I'm still,
I know it is.
There we go.
Okay, I still can't see myself, but that's all right. I don't need to see myself. So this first cover image, I just put this up here as an example of one of our photographs from our collection. This is one of the few official formal photographs we have of Mrs. Kennedy related to the White House Restoration Project. She's often behind the scenes. So this is one of her more public photos. This is a descendant of James Hoban, who was the original architect of the White House, born in Ireland. This is one of his, this is one of his descendants. And he is presenting a picture that belonged to his great grandmother, to Jacqueline Kennedy, for the White House Restoration Project. Okay, it's not letting me advance the slides. Okay. Many of the documents and photographs I'll share with you tonight are from the archival collections of the JFK Library in Boston. We hold all of President Kennedy's personal, congressional, and presidential papers. Everything from baby pictures to handwritten notes from Cuban Missile Crisis meetings. President Franklin Roosevelt started the presidential library system when he decided to give all of his papers to the federal government as a record of history for the public to access. Today, there are 14 presidential libraries administered by the National Archives and Records Administration. They span Herbert Hoover through Barack Obama. And they're usually constructed in the president's birthplace or close to it. I pulled out, this is a document that we have in our digital archives that has been digitized online. And it's a campaign document related to Mattapoisett, since the museum is sponsoring this talk. And it says to Stephen Smith, who is was Jean Kennedy Smith's husband and very active in President Kennedy's campaign. Enclosed are cards of two Kennedy supporters who want to hold a reception for Senator Kennedy at Silver Gull, Mattapoisett, Massachusetts, as soon as possible. They expect 8,000 to 10,000 people. They'd like to have word from you as soon as possible whether the senator would be able to attend such an event. These men called the senator's home to give me the information. So I just thought that'd be a fun thing to show you all.
Catherine, I own the building. It used to be the Silver Gull. Can I get a copy of this?
Oh, sure. I can email it.
I'll send you the link. I don't want to interrupt, but I'll talk to the museum. Thank you.
Sure. Sure. No problem. That's great. This is our mission. This is probably the slide with the most text that you'll see this entire evening. We are dedicated to the memory of the nation's 35th president and to all who, through the art of politics, seek a new and better world. And our purpose is to advance the study and understanding of President Kennedy's life and career and the times in which he lived, and to promote a greater appreciation of America's political and cultural heritage, the process of governing, and the importance of public service. All right, so when you hear the name Jacqueline Kennedy, no doubt you probably think of her iconic style, her pillbox hats, her Oleg Cassini designed suits and gowns. And we recognize her popularity among visitors to the Kennedy Library. And we also want to encourage them to move beyond the surface of her fashion sense and dig deeper into her lasting impact on the White House through her interests in history, arts, and culture. Tonight, I'll tell you about her restoration project, which spanned 1961 to 63. I will explain how Mrs. Kennedy decided to make this her central project, the goals that she had in mind, the process she and her advisors went through to restore the White House, and the lasting effects of this work. As a side note, you'll notice I referred to her as Jacqueline Kennedy or Mrs. Kennedy or the First Lady, rather than Jacqueline Kennedy Onassis, simply because Kennedy was her name during the time period I'm discussing. When Jacqueline Bouvier was a child growing up in New York, she loved horses, she took ballet and French lessons, and she enjoyed writing poetry, drawing, and painting. She graduated from George Washington University with a degree in French literature, having spent some time studying at the Sorbonne in Paris. When President and Mrs. Kennedy moved into the White House in 1961, Jacqueline Kennedy recalled a childhood visit to the White House with her family, and frankly, how disappointed she was in the house. She's told Life magazine, "From the outside, I remember the feeling of the place, but inside, all I remember is shuffling through. There wasn't even a booklet you could buy for a souvenir." Ultimately, she thought the tour of the FBI building in DC was the highlight of her trip, not the White House. At age 31, she became the third youngest First Lady, and the White House became her family's home. There was no doubt in her mind what her principal project would be, to reinvigorate the rich history of the White House. Her goal was not merely to redecorate, a term she disapproved of. "The White House must be restored," she said, "and that has nothing to do with decoration. That is a question of scholarship." She felt the restoration should reflect the whole history of the presidency as represented by furnishings both historically appropriate and of museum quality. Everyone from tourists to foreign dignitaries should be able to visit the White House and see the best examples of American history and culture. Even when President and Mrs. Kennedy were relaxing at Palm Beach before the inauguration, before the move to the White House, Mrs. Kennedy started studying up on the history of the house through engravings and old drawings. As early as 1961, a press release went out announcing the project. Just as Mrs. Kennedy gathered background on White House history, I'm going to share with you now some of the key moments of change in the building. This is by no means a comprehensive history of the whole house over its whole lifespan. In 1792, George Washington approved the original design based on the outcome of a contest for the design, which was won by Irish architect James Hoban. And this is his design. This is what his design was based on. This is Leinster House in Dublin, the President's House in Dublin. So it does look very similar to the White House. Construction of the original White House was slow, and Washington didn't live to see its completion. So he's the only president who never lived there. John and Abigail Adams were the first occupants. In 1814, as you probably know, the British burned the White House during the War of 1812. Dolly Madison famously saved the portrait of George Washington by Gilbert Stuart with the help of White House staff, including enslaved staff in the White House. The portrait has hung in the East Room since 1800. And during that fire, much of the interior architecture and furnishings were destroyed. Therefore, in 1817, President James Monroe took on the task of refurnishing the house. The Empire style was popular at the time, and he ordered several items from France in this style for the White House. I'll explain more about that later. In 1902, Theodore Roosevelt did a huge renovation and hired the architectural firm of McKim, Mead & White to restore the mansion to the neoclassical or Beaux-Arts style, which was fashionable at the time. Some examples of this style include the Boston Public Library, which was also designed by McKim, Mead & White, and the Jefferson Building of the Library of Congress. Theodore Roosevelt added the West Wing, and an elevator and electric lights were put in 1902 as well. In 1949, President Truman gutted the interior and replaced the interior with steel beams. The White House was structurally unsound at the time. Some said it was only staying up as a force of habit. That was kind of the joke about it. Margaret Truman, President Truman's daughter, was playing the piano and the leg of her stool went through the floor. That's how structurally unsound the building was. Harry Truman investigated and decided to move his family to Blair House for most of his presidency across the street while the White House was gutted. And the construction was so expensive that there was little money left for furniture, and the B. Altman Company offered to sell the White House, sell the Truman's furniture at cost and try and refurbish the White House with reproductions that they saw fit. This is one of my favorite photographs in our program that we have at the library on this White House restoration project. This is the basement here with a bulldozer going through it. And as you can see, the Truman renovation over on the left as well. Most of our visitors, their jaws drop open when they see these photographs. Today, the White House has 132 rooms, 35 bathrooms, 28 fireplaces, 8 staircases, and 3 elevators. Bear in mind that throughout all these years, the first families were taking and leaving furniture and belongings all the time. Many times, furniture was sold at auction. Mary Todd Lincoln, for example, had to sell much of Lincoln's furniture, sadly, because she didn't have enough money after he died. This is a photograph, this is a drawing from Jacqueline Kennedy's White House guidebook. And I just wanted to show you here, this is the blue room. You can see it's circular shaped. The blue room was for big receptions. It is where guests are received after the inauguration, for example. President Cleveland married his wife, Frances Cleveland, in that room. The green room is a parlor, as is the red room. This is the state dining room and the east room, where we often see musical performances on television, not in the White House. This is the diplomatic reception room, and this is where Franklin Roosevelt gave his fireside chats. Mrs. Kennedy stated her goal clearly in a letter to potential donors as we head back to 1961 here. With the success of the project, the White House would be a mecca for sightseers, a place where distinguished guests are entertained, and it will be all our founding fathers hoped it would be. Her scholarly project was rooted in historical research, enlisted the help of several experts, and struck a delicate balance between aesthetics and historical authenticity. Ultimately, she and her committee collected furniture and antiques that fit these categories. Something that belonged to a previous president, such as Andrew Jackson's candelabra. Something that was of the time period of a presidential administration, but not necessarily owned by the president. So Lincoln era chairs. Something that was American made. Tables by Duncan Fife, American furniture maker. Things that had American subjects. So a portrait by Benjamin Franklin by a Scottish artist would qualify for this collection. And things that were loaned from other museums. A table that belonged to Napoleon's brother from his estate in New Jersey. Bringing all of these historical treasures back to the White House was quite a process. Starting early in 1961, Mrs. Kennedy began to take action that would help ensure the project's success. She created the Fine Arts Committee of antiques enthusiasts, including Charles Francis Adams, who was a descendant of John Adams, Rachel Bunny Mellon, who would later design the Rose Garden, David Finley, who collaborated with Mrs. Kennedy on the restoration of Lafayette Square later on, Dorothy, also known as Sister Parrish, a New York interior decorator and friend of Mrs. Kennedy, Henry DuPont of Winterthur, a very well-respected expert in American decorative arts, was the chair of the committee. Jacqueline Kennedy was the honorary chair, and the role of the Fine Arts Committee was really kind of like a board that helped locate donations and help raise funds for the project. None of this was funded by taxpayer money. The Fine Arts Committee had an advisory committee, so the committee to the committee, which was comprised of museum curators all over the country. These individuals gave their expertise and connections, which helped donations happen. Here we have Mrs. Kennedy, the Fine Arts Committee, the Advisory Committee of Experts in Museum Collections. This is the first curator of the White House. Today, there's still a curator at the White House. The first curator is named Lorraine Pierce. She was a student of Henry DuPont at Winterthur. She was a student at Winterthur, so she was familiar with Henry DuPont's the way he worked and his style. I mentioned Sister Parrish, one of Mrs. Kennedy's contacts from New York, and then a French designer who worked out of Paris. These two would often butt heads, Winterthur, DuPont, and Boudin. You may or may not know that there is a law that says that the White House is a museum, it is a national monument, and it has a permanent collection. Mrs. Kennedy was instrumental in getting this law passed by Congress in 1961, and it helped ensure that the White House would have a lasting effect on all who visited it. So according to this law, articles of furniture, fixtures, and decorative objects, when declared by the president to be of historic or artistic interest, shall thereafter be considered to be inalienable and the property of the White House. Now, so what does that mean? Well, anything that is that Mrs. Kennedy collected with her committee when they were in charge stays in the White House, it's cataloged, it has an accession number, stays in storage if it's not on display. So first families cannot take historical items from the White House, and they can't bring anything in and leave it. It's really everything's organized the way a museum collection would be. So this is a summary of some of her actions that she took related to this project. Like I said, the press release was put out just 1 month after the inauguration, public law in September, the White House Historical Association was founded in 1961. They are celebrating their 60th anniversary this year, which is very exciting. The tour that some of you watching may have seen on television was broadcast on Valentine's Day, 1962. And this guidebook came out in 1962, National Geographic took the photographs, and Mrs. Kennedy and the curator wrote most of the text. A lot of the original text in the current guidebook is still there. So there's a White House guidebook today, and a lot of the text comes from Mrs. Kennedy's work. I know you really want to see the room, so we'll get there very soon. So what was the plan exactly? Mrs. Kennedy answers this question from Charles Collingwood during the White House tour in 1962. She says she doesn't really have a plan because, quote, this house will always grow and should. It just seems such a shame to have nothing of the past in the house, nothing before 1902. Then she references the Grand Palace in Colombia with all the history of Simón Bolívar that she noticed on a state visit there. I personally would argue that when she says she doesn't have a plan, it's because the White House is open to interpretation in her view. It's rooted in historical research, not based entirely on her personal taste. She could not paint the state dining room red just because she felt like it. And her plan would be shaped by what she could acquire for the house, her budget, and the various styles that run through the house. What was the process? Briefly, furnishings, wallpaper, fabrics, and objects were sometimes found in White House collections already and brought out of storage, dusted off, and spruced up. Mrs. Kennedy and her staff dug through storage and archives to match names and dates. There was a carpentry shop in the White House, a fabric restoration shop. So they would bring things out of storage and refurbish them on site. Sometimes items were donated, often donated. Sometimes they were underwritten by wealthy donors and sometimes reproduced as copies of the original or loaned from other museums. Here it was, this is the office of the curator. It was not unlike Antiques Roadshow in that each offered item was filed with a picture and a description and appraised by the committee who determined whether it should enter the collection. Mrs. Kennedy was heavily involved in processing the acquisitions. Funding came from private donors and later from the sale of the White House guidebook. We have a cartoon in our museum of a couple. They're just searching through the attic and they find a lamp and the husband says, do you think Mrs. Kennedy would want this for her project? So unsolicited donations arrive from around the country. Here's kind of where the Antiques Roadshow aspect comes in. Chairs, old washstands, rugs, quilts, a spittoon that supposedly belonged to Andrew Jackson, and it turned out it did. Three basement storerooms were designated to process all the donations. Over 95% of these things had to be returned because they were inappropriate or duplicates of already accepted things. So they started asking people to send a photograph of their item rather than sending it in a box to the White House. Mrs. Kennedy was truly a hands-on manager. She was not directing this project as a figurehead by any means. The photograph of her looking through the boxes was probably staged for Life magazine, granted. But her own notes from the files at the Kennedy Library give you a sense of just how in the weeds she was with the details. You can see here, they're looking at how to label the china, the dishes, to make sure that they can keep track of them with accession numbers. So I'll just let you read this for one moment. You can see she's looking to the Metropolitan Museum of Art for some guidance there. We have a lot of notes like this, just really detailed, well-researched plans that she has. Okay, now the moment you've probably been waiting for this whole time. We're going to delve into the state rooms. I'm singling out three rooms in the interest of time. The green room has mostly American items. The red room because of its cohesive style, and the blue room because the provenance or, life story of the items is very interesting and where they were found and added to the collection. Green room is typically for small receptions and teas. The Adams used it as a guest bedroom. James Monroe used it as his card room. Mrs. Kennedy used it as a parlor. This is the before picture, before the Great Restoration in 1952. You can see this is silk wallpaper, pretty dark green. This is John Quincy Adams' portrait. These items did belong to President Monroe, which many of his things that he purchased can be seen throughout the house, and not just in the 60s, but before then as well. This is the green room after. It's much brighter. Gives you a sense of how she collected American subject matter. So here we have orator Daniel Webster's sofa. This is a portrait of Benjamin Franklin by a Scottish artist. So not an American artist, but an American subject. This is a painting called Nocturne by James McNeill Whistler, portrait of Angelica Van Buren, who was Martin Van Buren's daughter-in-law and his de facto hostess. She was de facto first lady. And this is a portrait of John James Audubon, the naturalist. And this is Niagara Falls. So you see here how this is very American room. The red room here again, before and after from the same view. Red silk wallpaper. This is a portrait of Abraham Lincoln that later hung in the state dining room. I believe this is a portrait of Teddy Roosevelt. And this is the B. Altman furniture. So you can see that they're attempting to make it fit into the style of the room, but it's still not an antique and authentic historical item. But they're trying. We have to give them credit for trying. This is 1962. And here we've moved Teddy Roosevelt up there. This is George Washington. It's hard to see, but the red room has what's called the American Empire style. Now, where on earth does that come from? The artistic style was a bit all over the map when the Kennedys moved in. Henry DuPont, the head of the Fine Arts Committee from Winchester in Delaware, termed it eclectic because of all the changes that had been made over the years. It's my understanding from studying this subject that Mrs. Kennedy found the most cohesion throughout the house with the Empire style, which was popular in France in the 1800s. After the British burned the White House during the War of 1812, President James Monroe wanted to furnish the house with articles of the best kind and on the best terms, as he put it. Having served as US Minister to France under George Washington, President Monroe possessed a particular fondness for France and French style. The Empire style was popular during Napoleon's reign in the 19th century and was adopted by the European courts. Empire is characterized by geometric shapes based in Greek, Roman, and Egyptian forms. Typical motifs include acanthus foliage, imperial eagles, wreaths, urns, stars, and classical figures. Napoleon's brother, Joseph Bonaparte, owned a country estate in Bordentown, New Jersey, after he immigrated to the United States following the Napoleonic Wars. Mrs. Kennedy discovered through her research that Joseph Bonaparte was instrumental in bringing French Empire style to the United States, where it evolved into American Empire style, which we can see in the red room of the White House. So, file this away in your mind for a moment. You see here, this is Napoleon, painting from the National Gallery. These are bees, which was a popular symbol used by Napoleon. And over here, you can't see it very well, but there's the letter N on the arm of the chair. And there's a lion as well. So you see some of the motifs of the Empire style here, and you're gonna see even more in the Red Room. And I'm going to let Miss Kennedy take you around the Red Room for just a moment. And as a little bonus, before she starts on the Red Room, she's going to talk for a minute about a mantle in the State Dining Room, which has a really interesting story. So I'm going to stop sharing for one moment. And you all just yell at me if you can't hear this video, because I can't see you.
This is a perfectly beautiful room. Have you changed it a great deal?
No, we painted it white. This room's interesting because it has the most architectural unity of any room in the White House. It's really all 1902, when Theodore Roosevelt did the great restoration with Stanford White and his firm, McKim Eden White. The architecture, the consoles with the eagles, the furniture, the chandelier and the appliques. And it's interesting, people always think of Theodore Roosevelt with his stuffed animals and things. Few people realize that he was second only to Thomas Jefferson in his care and knowledge about the White House. In fact, he designed the one thing which is missing here, which will soon be given to us, a superb mantle. They, McKim Eden White had designed one with lion's heads, and Theodore Roosevelt said, no, the lion's not an American animal. So he designed it with buffalo heads of white marble, and McKim Eden White now is copying that for us. So you'll soon see it here to replace this just simple molding that was put in 1948.
And Mrs. Kennedy, on that fireplace, just under the mantel, there's an inscription which I found one of the most moving things in the White House.
Yes, that's from the very first letter that was ever written from the White House. It was written by John Adams, the first president to live here, to his wife Abigail, when he'd only been here 2 days, in November 2nd, 1800. And in it, it says, I pray heaven to bestow the best of blessings on this house and on all that shall hereafter inhabit it. May none but honest and wise men ever rule under this roof. It was Franklin Roosevelt who loved that prayer and had it put on the mantelpiece.
Mrs. Kennedy, I know that after a dinner in the State Dining Room, it's customary to withdraw to the Red Room. May we?
Yes, it's right here. It's one of the rooms that's used the most. So I'd like to show you what we've done to it. But before we go to the Red Room, you should look at this pier table. It's Empire, and it belonged to Joseph Bonaparte, Napoleon's brother, who came here after Waterloo. He lived in Bordentown, New Jersey, and had lots of his beautiful furniture with him. And his furniture was very important in transferring the French Empire style to America. This is lent to us by the Philadelphia Museum.
Oh, this is the most brilliant of the rooms that we've seen. I can see why they call it the Red Room. What is the fabric?
It's silk with a scroll border of gold. It's copied from an American Empire document. Everything in this room is Empire because the style of the room is dictated by the mantelpiece, which is Empire. This is one of the only two remaining mantels in the White House from 1817 after the fire. All the ones before were burned, and all the others in the house are either 1902 or 48. You see, it has the same Egyptian columns as the pier table we saw in the hall. That was because of Napoleon's Egyptian campaign and his desire to think of himself as a Roman emperor, have very heavy things.
That's American Empire in furniture, not in politics.
That's right. And this room has a beautiful carpet.
Which of these pieces have historical associations?
Well, there are quite a few. This is Dolly Madison's sofa. That's Nellie Custis's sofa, George Washington's granddaughter.
So, here we go.
So, to begin,
choose your color palette.
Keep going. Hang on. All right. So I just wanted to let Mrs. Kennedy take you around the Red Room a bit. That is from the February 14th, 1962 White House tour. And you can watch the whole thing on YouTube if you want to go back and watch the whole thing. It's about an hour long. Going to skip through this just a moment quickly here so I can get to the, in the interest of time. Here we have some of those motifs I was talking about. There's an urn and these are caryatids like you'd see on the Parthenon in Greece. Here we have the animal motifs. These are swans, very stylistic swans. Animal feet on the tables. Yeah, Grecian style sofa again, but an American furniture maker. These are actually dolphins. They don't look like dolphins really. Again, very stylized. And we've got these laurel leaves coming off of them. So the way this becomes American Empire from French is that you won't see any ends or bees in American furniture because that would refer directly to Napoleon and would not be American Empire, but they've taken some of the motifs from his time and made them more American. There's the before and after again there. This is just kind of a fun photograph here, just to show you that presidents do use the rooms. The White House curator said in a forum at the library that he's picked up wine glasses from sitting on historic furniture after a reception. So these rooms do get used and they are, you know, ultimately it is a house, so. All right. The Blue Room. The style of the Blue Room was also empire, and the Blue Room is typical for large receptions, as I said. The Kennedys used the state dining room and the Blue Room for state dinners. Mrs. Kennedy studied old engravings of the Blue Room and restored it to the arrangement under President James Monroe, including several pieces of his original belongings. This is a chair that President Monroe acquired. It's one of many from a set from Paris. And the chairs from the set, not all of them are together now, but one of the original chairs was donated by Miss Catherine Boland of Villanova, Pennsylvania, when she saw in the paper that they had found the table that goes with the set. So there's an article in the paper about the White House Restoration Project. Mrs. Kennedy found this Monroe pier table. Pier means it has glass in the back of it, which isn't there in this photograph. He found a Monroe era table in the basement, brought it upstairs and restored it. And then they put an article in the paper about this find. So this woman in Pennsylvania said, oh my gosh, I have a chair that goes with that set. So she donated her chair to the White House. They found another chair from another museum, but that museum didn't want to give up the chair because they wanted it for their own collection. And Charles Francis Adams, descendant of John Adams, said that he would underwrite reproductions of the other chairs. So this is just to show you kind of where all these things come from out of the woodwork. Here is the way the pier table looks in the blue room. This is a mirror or glass, so you can see that the room is reflected there. This is a portrait, or sorry, a bust of George Washington. You can, probably doesn't look like George Washington to you. It's an Italian American sculptor. Probably looks more classical to you, which was on purpose. And it was found in the men's room in the White House, in the restroom of the White House. So Mrs. Kennedy brought it upstairs and put it in the blue room where it was when President Monroe was in office. So again, things coming from all over. This is what the blue room looked like when it opened to the public in 1963. And here we have those chairs. I bet you can't tell which ones are reproductions and which ones the original. I certainly can't. These chairs are still in the room today, and a sofa from the Monroe set was acquired in 2012, I believe. No, that's not right. It was acquired during the Clinton administration, and that sofa is still there as well. So this is the blue room before. Again, we have the silk wallpaper and yellow tablecloth there, and this is the blue room. This is Kennedy's restoration, 1962. And I know you all have questions, so I'm going to zip through this. This is a presentation of the guidebook that I mentioned. It is still around today, different editions of it every time a new administration comes in. These are telegrams in response to the White House tour. I'll just read this one quickly. From Alexandria, Virginia. Mrs. Kennedy, expecting a tiresome program, your White House visit was culturally and historically spellbinding. Your elegance and quiet charm may well reverse a trend and lead the way to appreciation for the finer things. Count on our support. Mr. and Mrs. James Argadalis, 27 South Hudson Street, Alexandria, Virginia. Enjoyed Mrs. Kennedy's televised tour of the White House. After observing all her fine furniture changes, we know now why you're back. We now know why you're having a little back difficulty. Mr. and Mrs. Warren Peterson from Soundbrook, New Jersey. That one was to the president. These telegrams are all from the following day. February 15th. Your television tour of the White House was inspiring. May I suggest the rebroadcast be at an early hour so that the children of America can watch it. Also, I was distressed to read in this Wednesday, February 14th, New York Times, of the proposed demolition of so many historical houses of Lafayette Square in view of your and President Kennedy's great interest to preserve our historical objects of art. Can you not use your influence to maintain Lafayette Square as it exists in the sense of its being a public monument in its totality? Another from New Jersey. And sure enough, Mrs. Kennedy was involved in the historic preservation of Lafayette Square in Washington, D.C. It's 19th century buildings that were going to be torn down, replaced with office buildings. And she was also involved in the restoration of Grand Central Station when it was in danger of being torn down. She joined the fight to keep Grand Central. And in conclusion, I'd like you to take away that the White House restoration project was not an interior decorating project. it was a history project rooted in the lives and the presidencies of past presidents and American history and style. Today, if you go visit the White House, it is still a museum. Everything is there in the permanent collection. And we have Mrs. Kennedy to thank for her role in historic preservation and also increasing Americans' regard for the arts. And if you would like to learn more, welcome to visit our website. Please come visit us when we reopen. And please join us for Virtual President's Day, which will be February 15th from 11 to 2 online. We'll have activities for kids and adults, storytelling, creative at-home activities, musical performances, and more. So please join us for that. It is free. And I will end there. Thank you so much.
Thank you. That was fascinating. Do we have any questions? I think there might be a couple in there, Darcy.
We have some questions, which I'll read and ask for Catherine to answer. So the first question is the furniture in the residence portion of the White House part of the museum collection?
That's a good question. I don't think it is. The staterooms are really more the museum part. I think, if anything, the rules around the residence rooms are more flexible, where people can bring in their own more modern, if they want, furniture. Yeah, that's a good question. There may be a few items here and there of historical value, but ultimately the staff want the first family to be comfortable and have their own home space, which would be tricky if you're trying not to break, you know, Thomas Jefferson's candlestick.
Right. Okay. Thank you, Catherine. The next question is, last week, Melania Trump was supervising a photo shoot of restorations they did at the White House. Do you know what changes she made inside the White House?
So I didn't see the story from last week, but I know that the changes, to my knowledge, have been fairly minimal, mostly upkeep of wallpaper and rugs and curtains. I don't believe that she has made major changes, but I could be wrong if last week's story tells you something different.
Okay. I'll just remind everyone, if you have questions, please add them into the chat. Another question, do you expect that there will ever be another restoration of the White House, or perhaps changing exhibits of other artifacts in the White House?
I think just because it is a building that ages over time, just like any other building, there will need to be some structural restoration of the White House at some point. I'm not sure about collecting more historical items. I mean, time marches on, you know, and they probably need things from more recent presidents' time. So I would think that, it's not a static house, it's not a static process. So if the interest is there from the first family, I think it'll keep going as needed. And
okay. All right. We will ask Catherine to send a copy of the memo invitation about the Silver Gull.
I'm going to copy that down.
Yes, we have that information. And we do have the two owners of the Silver Gull here with us, but now it's a private home, Michael Esposito and Cynthia Riddell. So thank you. And here's a, oops, I don't want to miss a question. You may not be able to answer this question, but we'll ask it. The Grecian sofa with the dolphins, it's much like our New Bedford sandwich glass motif. If anyone is familiar with that.
Interesting. Yeah.
And we have another question. Did the gathering that was suggested for the Silver Gull in Mattapoisett actually happen?
I had that same question to myself. I was in suspense. I didn't find anything more about it, but it may just not, the document may just not have been digitized yet. We're still scanning documents and putting them online. So
what year was that?
1960.
Okay, because I know Kennedy, there was, he was supposed to have come to Mattapoisett at some point in, during, I think when he's running for Senate.
Okay.
When he came, and I know some of his family were here.
Yeah.
I don't know if that's related to that or not.
I'll see if I can figure it out. I'll go on a history hunt, the Silver Gull.
Yes, we also have Mr. Esposito reminded us that Julie Flanders Young is also on the call, and she lived in the Silver Gull as well. And it was open from 1953 to 1963. I happen to have a relative who had their wedding reception there. Carrie Tucker asks, what is the Silver Gull? We can open it up to Michael Esposito for a brief description.
I'm not sure.
I think he was unmuted and then he's muted. So
yeah, I was.
Oops, we can't hear you.
Yeah, I don't see how to unmute him. It's just,
maybe he can't do it.
I'm going to.
How's that? There we go.
There we go.
There we go.
Hello, Catherine. Thank you. This is Mike Esposito. My wife Cynthia is right here behind me.
Nice to meet you all.
The Silver Gull was a house that was built in 1917 by William York Peters. And he was a classmate of Teddy Roosevelt. We have pictures of him at Harvard. In fact, he became an architect and designed the front of the Porcellian Club at Harvard, which is, you know, where Zuckerberg at Facebook, you know, they wouldn't let him in at the time. Mr. Peters built this house. His wife was Amy
Dexter Sharp,
and that was the Providence family of Brown and Sharp. So they were both very Boston Brahmins, and he became an architect, and this was their summer house. After he died and she died, their three children, no one wanted these big old houses, and so it became the Silver Gull. There was another large house here in Mattapoisett at the center of the harbor called the Mattapoisett Manor, which is now our YMCA. And they'd heard this house was up for sale, and the people that owned the Mattapoisett Manor kind of ran it as a summer resort. Well, when they heard that this house was coming on the market, and they'd heard that some people were thinking of turning it into an inn, they didn't want the competition. So they bought the property and made it and named it the Silver Gull, and it ran for 10 years as an inn and a restaurant. And then you heard mentioned that Judy Flanders Young, her dad and grandfather started the company called the Acushnet Rubber Company and Titleist Golf Balls. And Dick Young, Judy's dad, owned the house from 64 till in early 80s. When another family purchased it, and then Cynthia and I bought it in 2002. So hello, Judy, nice to see you. And although we can't see you, I know you're on the phone. But thank you, Catherine. I'd never know. We try to collect postcards and memorabilia, menus, what have you. So it's great to be able to get something like that invitation.
Sure. Happy to do it.
There's always a Kennedy connection, right, Catherine?
Around here, yeah.
Yes, always. Okay, we have a couple of more questions. The marble bust of George Washington by Sirachi, was it from Barre, Vermont?
Did someone donate it from Barre, Vermont? I don't know. But the White House Historical Association has a digital library of a lot of what's in the collection. And I can look that up for you.
And the next question is, do you know which subsequent first ladies have carried Jackie Kennedy's mission forward?
So actually the Nixons collected more items than the Kennedys related to the White House Restoration Project, which is somewhat surprising that they would carry it on even further. So I would say that the Pat Nixon, for sure. I think she is really the first lady who did the most with the project. You know, because we have, first ladies have their projects. You know, Barbara Bush had literacy, Nancy Reagan had her project. So they have, I think, different interests, and not everyone has been focused on the White House restoration as much as Jacqueline Kennedy. And she did so much to pave that way forward that I think a lot of administrations just kind of built on what she had already done.
Yeah. Well, very good. There are no more, there are. Something. Yankee Magazine, Jean Cole tells us, just has an article on the generations of Italian marble crafters. So,
oh, interesting.
Yeah, something to look for. Do we have any more questions? Yes, it is amazing. There's a comment, considering she had only 3 years, that's amazing.
I have a question. I know you said that there's a curator, but do they have a full museum staff or?
That's a good question. Because we've had the curator at a forum at the library, and I mean
it's not like a tradition.
I think they have to send things out to be conserved, the way a museum would. Right. I think it's a pretty small staff.
Right.
Like I know the curator takes the first family around when they first move in and they choose which paintings they want on their room for the staterooms or the residences. So that person kind of is more like a registrar, I think, because they don't have exhibits. They don't have, but the White House Historical Association does a lot of programs. So as far as the White House staff goes, it may just be the curator and maybe an assistant. That's a good question.
Do we have any other questions out there?
Just about the curator staff thing, I have to say, I was looking at that thinking, wow, what a huge challenge. They're trying to, you know, curate these rooms that people are using for receptions all the time and moving glasses out around and everything. That's crazy. I don't know how they do it.
Yeah. I should be very patient, I guess.
Yeah.
Well, thank you, Catherine, for this great presentation. And thank you all for joining us. I know we haven't been able to do anything in person, but thanks for hanging in there and supporting us, and we do plan to have more events in the near future. So stay tuned and thanks again. And we will be getting your book in the mail. Did you have a...
Thank you. Let me just add one final note. I am recruiting docents for the museum. So if you're interested in John F. Kennedy and are interested in engaging the public with his life and times, you can maybe email Darcy. She'll give you my email address. Just because it's on YouTube, I don't want to put out my contact information, but I will be recruiting this summer into the fall. So let me know if you're interested.
Yeah, and we're not to compete with you, but we also appreciate anybody who wants to volunteer in docent as well. We're always here to, we appreciate anybody who wants to get involved.
Great.
And thank you very much. We are the co-presidents of the East Providence Historical Society, so we appreciate volunteers as well.
Okay. If anybody wants to volunteer at your local library or museum or whatever, reach out.
Yes, absolutely. Definitely. Couldn't do it without you.
We don't have a mail slot on our door, but you can send it to us at P.O. Box 535 in Nattapoisett.
Our East Providence Historical Society is on the grounds of the John Hunt House, which was the site of Stephen Payne's first mill in 1643, which is Cheryl's 10th great-grandfather.
Wow.
For the families that were moving down from Boston area and settling in the Ring of the Green in Rehoboth, Massachusetts.
Fascinating. Yeah, that's
so much history.
I know there's great history around here. Yes, there was another question about we did have a presentation on graveyards in Nattapoisett. That is on our YouTube channel, as this will be there as well. So that's, if you just go to YouTube and search for Nattapoisett Museum, you will find us there. Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Thanks again, Catherine, and thank you everybody for joining us tonight.
Thank you all. Take care.
Thank you.